had three services. This is my
This is your fourth?
Fourth, and then I have one tomorrow morning, but I don't have any after this, which is nice.
Wow.
Lisa, would you grab the candle thing there?
Three in one place?
Yeah, at St. Joseph's. You ready?
Thank you.
would be doing.
Thank you.
Good evening, and welcome to worship on this Christmas Eve. Tonight we celebrate the birth of our Lord God with us. Come, you faithful, and sing praise to God whose light has shined in the darkness. Rejoice, people of God. Tonight we light the candle of our Lord's Nativity. With the company of heaven and with sounds of great joy, God comes to us. We recall the words of the prophet that foretold of a Savior who would be born in Bethlehem. We proclaim with angels, glory to God, peace on earth, and goodwill to all whom God favors. We acknowledge the light of God that lives among us. At Christ's Nativity we pray. God of light and life, we give you thanks for your coming into our world, for walking among us and teaching us your way, and for touching all of heaven and earth with your glory. May the world be filled with your peace, and may our hearts be filled with your grace. Amen.
Thank you.
Our first reading for this evening comes from Genesis chapter 3, verses 8 to 15. They heard the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me the fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." And the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among men, among all animals, and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." Robert Allen tells of the time that someone asked him, "Where was the Garden of Eden located?" And he answered, "The Garden of Eden was located at 803 Blue Street in Hope, Arkansas." And the man had a surprised look on his face and asked, "Arkansas? I thought the Garden of Eden was supposed to have been somewhere in the Middle East." And Alan responded, "I don't really know where the biblical Garden of Eden was, but I know that my Garden of Eden was located on Blue Street in Hope, Arkansas. I was only 4 or 5 years old, and I did something that I knew was wrong. I took a quarter off my father's dresser without asking, and I went to the store and bought some candy. And as I sat there and ate it, shame overwhelmed me. Guilt gripped at my heart, and sin became a reality to me for the first time. My Garden of Eden was lost, and I was embarrassed by my sinfulness. The lush, secure world of a little boy had evaporated, and I headed home from the store aware that what I had done was wrong. Sin was no longer something only found in Bible stories. Sin was now a reality in my life." This third chapter of Genesis, the story of Adam and Eve and the Garden of Eden, attempts to explain how sin and evil came into the world. It is the story of sin becoming reality and of the fall of humanity. Genesis chapter 22, verses 15 to 18. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, "Because you have done this, and you have not withheld your son, your only son, I will indeed bless you, and I will make your offspring as numerous as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of their enemies. And by your offspring shall all the nations of the earth gain blessing for themselves, because you have obeyed my voice." Abraham trusted in God even to the point of sacrificing his own son. We too are called to place our trust in God, but trust is often fragile and difficult to give. In 1958, America's first commercial jet air service began with the flight of the Boeing 707. A month after that first flight, a passenger traveling on a different kind of airliner, struck up a conversation with a fellow passenger who just happened to be an engineer from Boeing. The engineer was wildly enthusiastic about this new, improved way to travel. He recounted Boeing's experience with engines and spoke at length about the extensive testing that Boeing had done before bringing the jet engine into commercial use. But when asked if he himself had yet flown on the new 707, the engineer replied, "I think I'll wait until it's been in service a little while." Trust can be hard. How much do we trust God? Abraham placed his trust completely in God, and from that moment on, he knew with absolute certainty that God would provide whatever was necessary to fulfill God's promises. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. In this passage, Isaiah reveals the source of the promised light and joy. His people should expect the birth of a child who will be directly descended from the line of David. Isaiah's birth announcement emphasizes the humanity of this Messiah, born to human parents. It contrasts the child's humanity with his divinity, and the frailty of his human form with the weight of his rule and his God-given authority. Isaiah also provides a list of names for this child. Name giving upon ascending to the throne was a common Middle Eastern practice, and the names chosen revealed the nature of the new king and his rule. This child would be known as Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace.
Thank you.
fourth lesson comes from Micah chapter 5, verses 2 through 4. But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, who are one of the little clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the people of Israel. And he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they shall live secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth. The fact that the deliverance of Israel would come from Bethlehem, Ephrathah, is a surprise. It tells us that God works through the small and the weak of the world to accomplish mighty purposes. But Bethlehem was already significant because David also came from this small village. These verses remind us that God can work through any one of us, no matter who we are, where we come from, or where we are on life's journey. At the appropriate time, the promised deliverer from Bethlehem would come and establish a kingdom of peace. He would shepherd his people and would be their peace. In the same way, we are called to bring peace to our world and to care for God's people. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Then Mary said, Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word. Then the angel departed from her. Max Lucado tells the story of a visiting professor who was about halfway through one of his lectures when a young man in the auditorium stood up and asked a series of questions. Are you telling us that God Almighty really became Mary's little boy? Yes, said the professor. Are you really asking us to buy into a religion based on a young girl's dream of divine pregnancy? Yes, said the professor. Are you insinuating that the life of Jesus then actually affects me now? Yes, said the professor. The young man stood silent for a few seconds and then said, How absurd. And sat down. Ours is an absurd religion. Everything about the nativity of our Lord is absurd. Mary was highly favored by God, which to the world meant that she was going to be a young, single mother, trying to explain to her betrothed the circumstances of her situation. But to God, it meant that she was chosen for a partnership that would fulfill God's will on earth. Mary was chosen, and she responded in faith, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." God's opportunity met with a willing faith. May the same be true for each of us. Our sixth lesson comes from Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. You've probably never thought about the fact that there is no great popular devotion to Einstein's theory of relativity. My guess is that it's beyond comprehension for most of us. Profundity without simplicity will always be limited in its appeal. The reverse is also true. Simplicity without it being profound will also have relatively limited appeal. If something can be understood completely and entirely, it will soon lose its power to fascinate and intrigue. In the story of the birth of our Lord, we find both. The most profound act of God in our world, in the simplicity of the birth of a child. The omnipotence of God in the helplessness of a tiny infant. This is the miracle of Bethlehem, and because of this, we have come to know God in the mystery of the profound and the simple. Our seventh lesson comes from Luke chapter 2, verses 8 to 14. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." God comes to us where we are, whether watching sheep in the fields of Judea or watching a live stream Christmas Eve service in our car or in our living room, because God is found in the places of human need. God does not ask us to make ourselves presentable or straighten ourselves out first. God knows how futile that has been for us. We are not able to go where God is, and so God came to us. Through Jesus, Emmanuel, God comes to us on our journey through the normal, messy, stressful, unexpected events of everyday life, in Judea or in Maryland. Christ comes to us right where we are, in the midst of our human predicaments and shortcomings, and reveals just how much God loves us. Chapter 2, verses 1 to 5 and 7 to 11. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? for we observed his star at its rising and had come to pay him homage. When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage. When they had heard the king, they set out, and there, ahead of them, went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. John Sturman tells the story of a Sunday school class that was putting on the annual Christmas pageant, and a young girl was chosen to represent all three of the Magi. When it came time for her entrance, she majestically swept up the aisle, draped in all the finest jewels garage sales could provide, and robes from the best remnants that the local craft store had to offer. Pausing and bowing before the manger, she announced, "Greetings, baby. I bring you gifts, gold, circumstance, and mud." Sounds kind of like life. Some gold, those precious moments we occasionally encounter. Lots and lots of circumstance, and mostly unpredictable. And then there's the mud. The places where we and our world get stuck like most of 2020. Barbara Brown Taylor once wrote, "I know this is a hard time of year. There is that empty chair to deal with, that stocking that stays folded in the box. All the rituals that were designed for two or more are now up to you alone. Christmas is the season you wait to see if the hurt has let up since last time this year, this time last year. And you want it to so you can get on with your life, and you don't want it to because that might mean that you have stopped caring. Meanwhile, the memories rise to meet you, swamping you with a melancholy so sweet you can almost taste it. For good or for ill, every Christmas Eve functions like a kind of time machine, taking us back to every other Christmas Eve we have ever spent on Earth. For some, it is a reminder of the way life used to be, back when we were the ones playing the role of the Magi in the Christmas pageant. For others, this night is a reminder of the way life should have been, but never was. All these hurts, all the longing and the disappointments, as well as all the gifts that we have to offer, we can bring before this child in the manger, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, as well as circumstance and mud."
Thank you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right for us to give our thanks and praise.
It is our joy and our salvation at all times and in all places to give thanks to you, Almighty and everlasting God, because the light of your glory has come into our world. Your Son, our Savior, who existed before the world was called into being, was born for us of Mary, that we might become your children. He became poor that by his poverty we might become rich. He was humbled that we might be exalted. He gave us peace and joy when we were without hope. With the whole company of the saints in heaven and on earth, we proclaim and celebrate the birth of our Savior.
Holy, 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 holy,
Lord God of hosts, the whole universe sings of your glory, revealed to us in the birth of our Savior. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace to God's people on earth. When Jesus was at the table with his disciples, he took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "This cup that is poured out is the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So we join in declaring the mystery of our faith.
Your death we proclaim, O Lord, and your resurrection we confess
until you come again. Let us pray. Beloved in Christ, as we celebrate the coming of our Lord into the world, let us hear again the message of God's unending love found in Scripture. From the first days of our disobedience, to the glorious redemption brought to us by this holy child. Let us pray for the needs of the whole world, for peace on earth and goodwill among all God's people. Let us remember in his name the poor and helpless, the cold, the hungry and the oppressed, the sick and all who mourn, the lonely and the unloved, and all who do not yet know of God's eternal love. We humbly offer these prayers to God, and we share in the words Christ taught us to say when we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Loving God, send your Holy Spirit that we may be nourished and strengthened through this simple meal, that we might be united in the body of Christ, and that we might remain your servant church. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup for which we give thanks is a sharing in Christ's blood for the forgiveness of sins. Come, all who hunger and thirst for righteousness, all are welcome at God's table. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take and eat. This is the body of Christ broken for you. Take and drink. This is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, shed for the forgiveness of sins. Let us pray. We give you thanks, eternal God, for the salvation you have offered through the gift of your Son. Keep us in this hope that we have grasped, so we and all your children might be free, and the whole earth might praise your name. Amen. chapter 1, verses 1 to 5 and 10 to 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believe in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born and not of blood or of the will of the flesh, but of the will of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. The coming of Jesus Christ into the world is God's ultimate redemptive act. The mysterious I Am now has a name, Jesus the Christ, Emmanuel, God with us. In this act, God has become personal. To all who receive him, who believe in his name, he gives the power to become children of God. For many of us, on this holiest of nights, the personal nature of the Nativity is expressed in the singing of Silent Night. Stille Nacht was first performed on Christmas Eve in 1818 in Austria. A young priest, Father Josef Mohr, asked Franz Gruber, a schoolmaster and organist in a nearby village, to compose a melody for a poem he had written. He requested it be written for guitar because flooding had damaged the church organ. Maybe there were some present that Christmas Eve, more than 200 years ago, who were disappointed in the circumstances. A Christmas Eve service without the organ, a change in tradition. But through those circumstances, we were given one of the most beloved of Christmas carols. Although this year is different in many ways, we still share the light of Christ here in this place, and in a world searching for that light. Let us reflect on this holy night as we light our candles and hear once again the familiar carol that has become so much a part of Christmas tradition.
Thank you.
shines in the darkness, guide your path. May you be filled with peace and goodwill. And may the blessing of God be upon you and remain with you always. Lord, let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations, and the glory of your people Israel. Amen.